Hello everyone, welcome back to Let's Play Bloodborne. Last time we opened up a bunch of shortcuts around Central Yharnam, but we still have the aqueducts left to go through and a lot of this district left to explore.
You're a hunter, aren't you? Then, well, do you know of any safe places? I've heard I have. Shutting up indoors isn't always enough. Well, if you hunters got off your asses, you wouldn't be in this mess. You're obligated to help me, you hear? So what'll it be? Are you going to tell me you're not? Yeah, I should have known. You're good for nothing. No respect for the elderly is what that is. That little good you outsiders do. Go on, admit it. You think we're all mad, don't you? Well, go and stop it! I know all your tricks. Now, what is it in there? I've much better ways to pass the time. In this. Go on.
So we don't have anywhere for that elderly lady in the house to go. So when you talk to her at this stage in the game, you really don't have anything to tell her except, no, I don't have any place to send you. I don't have a safe haven for you. When we come back to her later on, maybe we can help her out a little bit. Before I make that drop down, yeah, there's a torch lighting the wall down here, so there's this wolf man. And we will take care of him before dropping down. These guys are so dangerous. Oh, I didn't mean to do that. I think if you hold X down and you move the DualShock 4, you can actually do the gestures with the gyroscope and the DualShock 4. So yeah, we'll help out the NPC up there later on. We'll come up here, and you can see there are a couple of bodies tied to rope or chain. Looks like chain, actually. Either way, you can cut the bodies down, and they'll fall to the sewer floor below. And there's another one on the other side. Pull the torch out and get a little bit better lighting in here. I'm always worried up here that when I take a swing, my character is going to step forward and I'm going to go over the edge, so I'm very careful when I do that. And from here, there's actually not a way back up to that window because we drop, so we'll just drop down to this floor. And falling damage from that height, not a big concern. Oh! Yeah, I was going to wait for this guy to turn around and patrol away so I could backstab him. Kind of stealthy-like, but nah, there's just a guy shooting at me. Praise the gun. Gun is so kick-ass in this game, and there are a lot of guns. Some of them, you will see some shit. Actually, you'll see one right after the next boss that is ridiculous. Where is that guy at? Usually he's like a few columns over. No, he's gonna pop out, I think, as I go to kill this wolfman. No, he's staying hidden. Oh, where the fuck is he at? He's got to be, I guess, near the door on this side, the opposite end of the room. I know there are a couple of items. I'm almost passing over. There we go. I'm still not sure where this guy went. You could see rats waiting for us down there if we drop down. Not sure if I want to drop first or if I want to go through the door first. No, actually, you know what? The first thing I want to do is find the... There you are. Wow, he's normally not positioned in that spot. That makes him way easier to kill because you have a little bit of room to hide to approach him. So we'll come out here first. This whole area feeds back in on itself. That guy's got a top hat. Do all the riflemen have top hats? I don't know. So I don't want to fight this wolfman in line of sight, the other two. Holy shit, he hit me through the wall. Great. Love that. Feels really dope. Thank you. I would like some more. Have some whip. Would you like some cool whip? This is a badass whip. As he fires approach him. Yeah! There was a pretty cool gif on, or was it a webm, on the Bloodborne subreddit of somebody jumping over a bullet. Like, I think it was right around here. I think it was this enemy, too, they jumped it. The hitboxes are dramatically improved in Bloodborne. They are, even if you're not comparing it to the other Souls games where the hitboxes have always been garbage, even if, like, you're just comparing it to games with, you know, good hitboxes, normally, the Bloodborne hitboxes are really good. Incredibly accurate. Accurate enough to where you can jump over bullets, and the jump does not really have that much invincibility, so wasn't using that to get over it. Just straight sailed under his foot. Hitbox porn. I think that's the name of the thread on the Reddit. Okay, so yet again, we come to Corpse on the Rafters, but over here I want to say there's some more cold blood dew. No, that's an oil urn. Haven't picked one of those up in a little while. Okay, let's see if I can not screw this one up. Paranoid now. The fall's not gonna kill me and I can get back up easily. I would just like to be able to fall. Oh, bloodstone shards. Those are upgrade materials. And now we're back at the bottom level of the aqueduct. And somewhere around here, right here, is a ladder that leads back up. But before we go back up, let's see, the two items from the bodies we cut down are on either side down here, but there's something being guarded by rats that I think is a very interesting item. Oh no, the whip clanged off the wall! That almost ended really bad. Madman's knowledge. Let's check this item out, because its description hints at some real shit to come. Skull of a madman touched by the wisdom of the great ones. Used to gain insight, making contact with eldritch wisdom is a blessing, for even if it drives one mad, it allows one to serve a grander purpose for posterity. I'm just gonna play that one where it lies. I think you understand the possibilities that that is hinting at in this story, and boy is the story of this going to go in some directions that I, in particular, being a giant Lovecraft fan and nerd, I adore. I also find it super interesting that using the knowledge of a madman touched by the wisdom, the eldritch wisdom of the great ones, provides you with insight. And insight does some things which I have just now learned about, which, ah, God, no, that would spoil too much if I said it. There are some things about insight that kind of tie it to, not directly, like, story-wise tie it, but insight has a function very similar to character or world tendency from Demon Souls, in the way that it impacts the game. It's much more than what I thought it was before. It has some special functions that have just now been uncovered. Which we will see more of as we get later into the game, something to look forward to. On this side, I believe we have something pretty cool in its own right. Although not as cool as knowledge of a madman. Madness is, it's gonna be a recurring theme in this game. It was a strong theme in the Souls games, it'll be a strong theme here. From that body that we cut down in the rafters, we pick up a saw spear, which is a pretty good weapon. It's one of the trick weapons of the workshop, commonly used by those who dedicate themselves to the hunt. This saw, effective at drawing the blood of beasts, transforms into a medium-range spear. The saw, with its set of bloodletting teeth, has become a symbol of the hunt, only grows in effectiveness the more grotesquely transformed the beast. And we'll also take a look at the threaded cane. It's sufficiently deadly as a rigid bladed cane, but also serves as a whip when its blade is split into many. Concealing the weapon inside the cane and flogging the beast with a whip is partly an act of ceremony, an attempt to demonstrate to oneself that the bloodlust of the hunt will never encroach upon the soul. So the whip is as much a weapon as it is a ceremonial tool. This, by the way, is the saw spear. Back at the start of the game, we could have picked a starting weapon called the saw cleaver. It's what you saw in the very first Project Beast leak trailer. And you've probably seen a lot of other people using the saw cleaver because it's a pretty good weapon. The range isn't so great. It makes up for the lack of range with a whole lot of damage and very fast attack speed. And here, we're going to take a look at a Spectre, because we haven't actually talked about this system yet. That just sat me down. Weird. I was having issues with Spectres on a different character. I've since gone online since the last two episodes, which I recorded offline. I should be able to see them, though. Yeah, I'm not able to conjure one up either by hitting X or holding X. Holding X just sits me down. Wonder if it's bugged. Either way, let's talk about the online real quick. So another really cool aspect of the Souls games and Bloodborne is this pretty unique asynchronous multiplayer element. I did the last few episodes offline, but I went online here. So let's see if I can get him to... There we go. I don't know why I was sitting down before. Might be having server connection issues since the game just launched, I don't know. Yeah, that's a Spectre. So, actually, I'll save this note for later. We can see little phantoms, echoes of other players in their own worlds roaming around, playing asynchronous to our own playthrough. We'll see those periodically. They appear white and opaque. It lets us read messages others have left. Sometimes those messages are trolly, sometimes they are jokes, like tongue butthole, don't give up skeleton. Best message in all of Dark Souls 2. Sometimes they offer legitimately good advice, like they can tell you about weaknesses for bosses, positioning tips for killing bosses easily. Yeah. So you can read notes that other players leave you, you can rate their messages, or you can rate them, was it, it's fresh or foul in this one, negative or good, basically. And the Spectres give you a rough idea of how they were killed, or what they were doing and where they were killed. You can't actually see what they were fighting, but if you see a whole bunch of Spectres in an area that you've never been to before, you can assume that there's something pretty fucking heavy waiting at the end of that area, as we'll see coming up. The online in this also allows you to invade other people for PvP, or you can do co-op with them. We'll show that off a little bit more later on. Oh, I don't think we... There's the hitboxes working against me. That straight R2 stab attack just sailed right over it. Oh, god damn it. The crows coming down from the rafters above just scare the shit out of me. And they just drop pebbles. Excellent. You can see there's something big waiting for you. So let's warn some other people about what's coming up here. What do I want? Fear? Yeah, that's good. I want to use a template to make this. Treat blank with care. Now, would this thing that I'm thinking of be a concept, or would it be a place or a thing? It should be one of those two. I'm not seeing it, though. I'm seeing a lot of emotions, the unseen, all as well. What about places or things? That should be it, right? Hidden path? No, not quite what I'm wanting. This is really taking the oomph out of this witty, biting message I'm about to leave. Patrol, tactics, I don't think it would be a tactic, unless leading them into a thing that I'm thinking of. Come on, it's one word. Just looking for one word here. Oh man, maybe it... I hope they didn't remove it. There's no way they would have. It's too much. That word is too much of a staple. Whatever, I was going for treat butthole with care, or treat hole with care even. Can't find it, maybe it's not a template word. They assured us that we could still tongue butthole though. This is a giant pig. You can in fact stab it in the butthole for a visceral attack. Would you like to butthole stab this pig? If you could get around behind it, like I'm failing to do, you can absolutely pull that shit off. So the pig, when you first approach the tunnel, will roar, and that gives you enough time to actually get into this little, more open area of the arena to fight it, so it doesn't charge you and immediately kill you. We also picked up the Soul Hunter badge there. The badge crafted long ago at the workshop attests to one's prowess as a hunter or beast. The workshop is gone and no group recognizes this meaningless badge except the messengers in the bath who understand its profundity. Certain things can only be entrusted with a hunter in possession of this badge, and one of the badges crafted by the Healing Church, the Silver Sword is a symbol of a church hunter. Ludwig was the first of many Healing Church hunters to come, many of whom were clerics, as it was clerics who transformed into the most hideous of beasts. That second one that I read was the badge that we got from killing the cleric beast. I think this is a straight drop down. And then the second one is what will let us purchase the Kirkhammer back at the Hunter's Dream. And the first one that you find in the sewer, the first one that I read, that we just picked up by the giant pig, allows you to purchase the other starting weapons. So to recap, the starting weapons we could have chosen from were the threaded cane. You guys are stupid. You trigger your trap too early. The weapons we could have started with were the threaded cane, the saw cleaver, and the hunter's axe. I picked the threaded cane. Now that I have the saw hunter's badge, we can go back to the hunter's dream and pick up the other two. The hunter's axe and the saw cleaver, if I want them. So there's the ladder that leads up there to the brick-wielding ogre and the townsfolk. But you notice when we went into the tunnel, we passed by a different ladder. So let's see where that would have taken us. Oh, it's right there. And yeah, you could see there was a specter. Because that pig charged out of the tunnel and just ruined someone's day. This ladder leads out to the other end of a bridge. And before we go down that bridge, here's one more cool little shortcut for us. I told you, we're still not done with all the shortcuts in Central Yard. Oh, my glows are freaking out on me. We're still not done with all the shortcuts in Central Yharnam. If you notice where this is, once again, we are pointing right back at the Central Yharnam Lantern and Gilbert next to it. In fact, we've seen these two ogres before. We passed by them. We're by the kennels right now. Ooh, hey. I want to get backstab. Ooh, they actually don't have that much health. This will help me demonstrate a good point, though. If you noticed, my health bar turned a little bit orange there when I took that hit. That is part of a new mechanic in Bloodborne, which you might have heard of. It's a health regeneration system. Although, health regen is kind of a misnomer. It's actually more like a short window of time where you can leech back some of your lost health. And yeah, we're right back at the kennels. When the health bar turns orange, that's the damage that you've just taken when you get hit. If you counterattack an enemy right away, you can regain some of that lost health. You have a few seconds to attack before it just goes away. Or if you get hit again, it'll also just go away. And when you're counterattacking someone, you might have seen a few times, you get this little cloud that covers you when you hit someone and you recover that little bit of health. It helps keep the pace of combat up, so you're not just backing off immediately out of instinct when you get hit. Your first instinct shouldn't always just be to back up and heal. Sometimes that's still the right choice. It's still the cautious thing to do, but Bloodborne, you kind of walk this line between caution and recklessness, which is really cool. Between the dashing, that health regen, the speed, and the lack of a shield or the lack of blocking, you walk this line between like smart, calculated, decisive attacks and reckless abandon, and it can totally trick you into making the wrong choice. Like, you can go into this desperate assault, and in that desperation, you know, get your health back. But it can lead to you making poor decisions. That desperation can just as easily get you killed. So it's asking, do you want to cut your losses, or do you want to go for broke? In an interview a while back, Miyazaki said that he doesn't look at it as a health bar. He sees it as your will to live, and as you get hit, you're plunging closer and closer to despair. And this bridge, yeah, this is the other end of the ladder. So that boulder, that flaming boulder, was meant to trap us, but instead it took a group of like five villagers out. Yeah, he sees it as your will to live. And you can, in his philosophy of this, you can cling to hope by desperately fighting back. So there's not just a game mechanic at work there. There's philosophy behind it. That wild-ass thrashing attack is what scares me about those enemies. They can do a whole lot of damage all at once. But they do tend to drop two blood vials at a time. Before we head up the stairs to what is going to be a boss encounter, as you could probably guess, I'm not really sure where Eileen is. I've been looking for her, and I have just forgotten her location. So we're going to look around for her. I remember where she is. She's, we actually passed right by her when we made that drop down in, this area over here. I want to call it a church, but I don't think that's what it is. I'm actually not sure what this building is supposed to be. Yeah, we passed by this door entirely.
Oh, a hunter, are you? And an outsider? What a mess you've been caught up in. And tonight of all nights. Here, to welcome the new hunter. Prepare yourself for the worst. There are no humans left. They're all flesh-hungry beasts now. Still lingering about. What's wrong? A hunter unnerved by a few beasts. No matter. Without fear in our hearts, we're a little different from the beasts themselves. What are you still doing here? Enough trembling in your boots. A hunter must hunt.
Yeah, let's check out that gesture we just got, because it's a really cool one. If you're wondering how you get that, you just find Eileen and talk to her and exhaust her dialogue. Yeah, like that. And she also gives you a bunch of bold hunter's marks, which function as homeward bones. It actually reminded me to go looking for her because we picked those two bold hunter's marks up near the two wolfmen near the boss door. Actually really glad I picked those up, because Eileen has a quest line and she'll move around a bunch, and I almost forgot to trigger the start of it. So with that done, we're gonna go fight the boss. Before I do that, I have a bunch of souls, or a bunch of blood echoes that I'm gonna go cash in at the Hunter's Dream. So I'll go do that, and we will cut when we're back to the boss. See you in a sec. And we're back. Nice thing about doing it this way is I get to show how quick the run back is with the newly opened up shortcut using the elevator. So all you do is you come over here to the left from the central Yharnam lantern again, trying to struggle to avoid calling it a bonfire. Just like it's gonna be real hard not to call Blood Echoes souls. So we come right into the elevator, and that already brings us back up to the bridge, and it's just a quick trip across the bridge to the boss. One way to make the run back even a little bit quicker is step on the switch to send the elevator back up when you're at the bottom of it. That way, if you die to the boss, you don't have to wait for the elevator to come back to you, to run back to him. So, you can just run past these guys. I like to keep them at a distance with the whip, and then we'll wait for the ogre to set the trap off. Oh, hey, that didn't get all of them. No problem, I picked up the 710 split for him. And this is also a pretty okay way to farm blood vials, because there's a group of five there, they go down pretty fast. There's the ogre up here and the townsman, and there are the two wolf people up here. Beware of beast transfer, mate. Motherfucker, I stopped to read a message, and that happens.
Beasts all over the shop. You'll be one of them, sooner or later.
Father Gascoigne is the coolest, baddest motherfucker. I adore this boss. Yeah! Let's go! Let's go! This boss kicks ass! He's quickly becoming one of my new favorites. Father Gascoigne kicks so much ass. This fight is pretty challenging, but more than that, what makes this fight for me is this is a duel with a really cool opponent who is just a much better, stronger version of another hunter, basically. It's not exactly that, but it's like a character action rival battle. It is so fast. It's so fast, in fact, that you really have to be careful about your stamina management. Oh my god, this is so dope.
What's that smell? The sweet blood. Oh, it seems to me it's enough to make a man sick.
Oh, unfortunately, in phase two, we don't get that sick, like, uppercut with the axe where he scrapes it along the floor anymore, but he does have a new ability, a bunch of them that he uses here. He's a leaping attack. He'll do, like, a 720. There we go. Oh my god, this is so good. I wish it could last longer, but it's gonna be over pretty quick. We'll show some more cool stuff off about this fight later, though. In just a moment. Oh, I'm getting on the back foot, Lil. There we go. If you're really feeling like being cheesy, you can hide behind the graves and you can't destroy them in his first two phases. So remember that music box we got from his daughter? Yeah. Bury the lead on this one a little bit. His last phase, he transforms fully into a werewolf. A dapper lycanthrope. At that. Savage yet refined. Oh, God, yes. So you can parry him in this form. Also in this form, he can melt your cheese. He can go through those gravestones. And you can use the music box one more time in this phase. Be warned that if you stun him with the music box too much in the other two phases of the fight, he will transform much more quickly, like at 70 or 80% health. That is that short but very sweet fight, though. God damn, I wish that lasted longer. You could draw it out, but still. Let's check that tomb key out, though. Key to the gate that blocks the Tomb of Erdin. Beyond the tomb, Erdin Chapel can be found in the center of the Cathedral Ward. Only today, the church is abandoned, and some say that the residents of Erdin have all gone mad. What an intense, fun, cool fight. That is. So there's more. The fight's done, but we're about to learn some things about him. So if you drop down from this upper floor in the arena onto the roof, you find bloodstains everywhere, and you find the dead body of a woman, and she is holding a red jeweled brooch. Uh-oh. So this has to be the kid's mom. Remember she said their mom wore a red jeweled brooch? A woman's bright red brooch engraved with the name Viola. Yeah, that kind of confirms it. Same name on the music box. Perhaps the jewel is a gift from a hunter, used to change into a droplet blood gem that fortifies any weapon. With a proper workshop tool, various weapons can be fortified. Yeah. That kid's mom is dead. And to add to that, it's really likely that Gascoigne is the one who killed her. And we just killed her dad, which makes her an orphan now. I say that it's likely that he killed the kid's mom, and that's because his mind is already clearly far gone, and he's a beast. And the music box states that playing it would help the kid and her mom remind Gascoigne of who they were when he forgot them. So I think that he killed Viola, and when you play the music box to make him lucid, he remembers doing it and becomes so sickened with himself that he can't handle the sound. One more tidbit about him, he is a member of the Healing Church, but Father is not a rank or name that they use for their priests. The Bergenworth Spider hides all manner of rituals and keeps our lost master from us. A terrible shame, it makes my head shudder uncontrollably. The Bergenworth Spider! We're gonna meet the Bergenworth Spider eventually. And we come to our first chest. I'm actually really bummed out that I don't think mimics are in the game anymore. It kind of pisses me off. We do get a workshop tool, though, our first one. This one enables the fortification of weapons using blood gems by kneading blood gems into them. Blood gems add properties to weapons when used to fortify them as blood defines an organism. We'll get into the upgrading and fortification of weapons more probably next time, maybe the episode after. Not sure yet. We're about to enter Erdin Chapel proper, though. This appears to be the source of the bell ringing that we've been hearing, or maybe not, I'm not sure, to be honest. Sounds like it, though. Before we return to the Hunter's Dream and end things off, let's talk to this really disfigured-looking NPC over here.
Hmm? Oh, you must be a hunter. Very sorry. The incense must have masked your scent. Good, good. I've been waiting for one of your ilk. These hunts have everyone all locked up inside, waiting for it to end. It always does, always has, you know, since forever. But it won't end nicely, not this time. Even some folks hiding inside are going bad. The screams of women folk, the stench of blood, the snarls of beasts, none of them's too uncommon now. Yharnam's done for, tell ya. But if you spot anyone with their wits about them, tell them about this here Erdin Chapel. They'll be safe here. The incense wards off the beasts. Spread the word. Tell them to come on over. If you wouldn't mind. I know I shouldn't be asking ya, but if you happen upon someone while hunting, tell them about this here Erdin Chapel. If they seem worth being told, that is. Oh, and I do sincerely hope they are.
I don't trust this person, do you? Either way, it does seem like a safe haven, and we did have an NPC who was looking for that, so maybe we will tell her about it. Anyway, that's gonna do it for now. Thanks for watching, everyone. Take it easy. Have a good one.